Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another Ask Ian Q&A on Forgotten Weapons. I'm Ian, and today our question comes from Dennis on Patreon. Dennis asks, what rifles were between the M1 Garand and the M14? I went through basic with an M14, and I know the M15 was supposed to be a BAR replacement. Yeah, it was basically a heavy-barreled, bipod-fitted version of the M14. Google doesn't really find anything on the M2 through the M13. That is a really interesting question, and it's one that could be applied to a bunch of other things, like what came between the M9 and the M17 pistols. But we'll focus specifically on the rifles today, and the answer for this lies fundamentally in the fact that the Army has rifles for a lot more specific things than just infantry rifles. So in this span from World War II through the Vietnam War, there were only three iterations of infantry rifle, the M1, the M14, and the M16. But there was a bunch of development of other guns for other things. Specifically, we have subcaliber rifles, we have training rifles, we have spotting rifles, we have survival rifles. So remember that during much of this period, the Air Force is actually the U.S. Army Air Force, not the standalone independent branch of service. And so for a while after World War II, rifles adopted by the Air Force are still part of the Army, the overall Army system. So I have some notes here because this is a lot of guns to keep track of. So the M2 we can start off with, that's one of the training rifles. It was a bolt action rifle. It's actually an improved version of the M1922 training rifle. They updated it during World War II and redesignated it the M2. And I actually have a whole video on that rifle, so I'll link to that at the end or in the description text. M3 is a number that actually was not used by the Army, and I don't know why. M10 and M11 were also not used, and I don't know why. My guess would be that those were numbers that were set aside for a project that didn't end up happening. I would think I'd be able to find some record of those sorts of guns, but I haven't been able to. Perhaps someone doing a whole bunch of really deep dive could figure out what those numbers were perhaps earmarked for. But the short version for today's video is 3, 10, and 11 were never used. The M4 was a survival rifle for pilots. This was designed by Harrington Richardson. It is a really little bolt-action, collapsing stock 22 Hornet rifle. I haven't done a video on that one yet, but we have a picture of one. The M5, see, these things all bounce around because it's chronological, so it's not like they did infantry rifles 1, 2, and 3, training rifles 1, 2, and 3. No, it's all different things that they're looking for as years progress. So the M5 is a subcaliber rifle. It is a 22 caliber it's a 22 caliber insert for a 37 millimeter gun, so that you can practice all the procedures for a 37 millimeter on a range that only needs to be able to handle 22 rim fire. So that was the M5. I think that actually used like old 1917 machine gun barrels cut down and put into a 37 millimeter shell shaped insert that you can put into a gun. The M6, we go back to a survival rifle. This time it's a design from the Ithaca Gun Company, and it is an over-under that is 22 Hornet and 410 shotgun, carried not in the buttstock. It had a little compartment to carry, I think it was 9 rounds of Hornet and 4 rounds of 410 shot shells, intended as a survival rifle for pilots who got shot down. I have also done a video on that one, so I'll include a link to it as well in the description below. That was a video I did a long time ago. It's actually, that video is a two-parter. It's the US M6 survival rifle and also the Luftwaffe M30 survival rifle, both of them being combination rifle shotgun. All right, moving along, we get next to the M7. The M7 is another subcaliber gun. This time it is a 30 caliber, so it's a 30-06 projectile or cartridge being fired out of an M20 75 millimeter recoilless rifle. Same idea. Subcaliber in general is a way to take an artillery piece that produces all sorts of tons of noise and needs a very long range, and you know, you have to have a lot of consideration for impact safety. Well, scale that thing down, you're not going to get the noise, you're not going to get the recoil, but you can practice all of the sighting and loading and sort of crew procedure drill. So The M7 is a 30 cal subcal for the 75 millimeter recoilless rifle. I'm going to skip past here for one moment. The M9 is essentially the same thing for the 106 millimeter recoilless rifle. Exact same idea. It's 30-06 caliber. It's an insert put into the gun, makes easy training on a recoilless rifle. Now going back, the M8 is not a subcaliber rifle. It is a spotting rifle. I have I have two videos on the M8. One of it, how it works and taking a look at its history, and one of it actually out at the range doing some shooting. It was essentially a short 50 caliber round the M8 itself was a semi-automatic action. I guess it's a semi-auto rifle. It has no buttstock. It's meant to be bolted to the top of a recoilless rifle and used essentially to aim the thing before you touch off one of the recoilless rounds that has a tremendous amount of blast and signature. You know, you fire off one of those and you need to immediately move, so you can aim the thing first by firing what is in comparison a little wimpy 50 caliber tracer to figure out exactly where you're aimed. And it was a proprietary 50 caliber cartridge because it was specifically designed to match the trajectory of the 106 recoilless rifle projectile so that you could in fact aim at long range with the spotting rifle. So that gets us, that's the M8, we already did the M9, the M10 and M11 were not used, numbers were not used, and then the M12 and the M13 were both 22 caliber training rifles. I think there are actually a couple different rifles that came under these designations. The commonly recognized one is the H&R M12, and then the M13, I know Remington made a training rifle that was designated M13. There may have been another one that also got that designation. The training rifles get a little screwy that way. And then, of course, we have arrived at the M14. So this is, hopefully that was interesting. It's fun digging into what all of those different things are, and it really makes you realize just how much stuff goes into military procurement beyond just the standard guns, especially when you get into heavy equipment. You have to deal with not just the large caliber artillery piece itself, but all sorts of extra gear that's required to be able to effectively and practically train with it. By the way, one of the other interesting things you'll get to is in U.S. nomenclature, there's rifles and then there's also guns, and the guns are larger caliber than rifles. I think gun was above 50 cal, essentially a cannon. And so there's also a bunch of subcaliber guns for the large stuff, where you might have a 75 millimeter gun that has a 37 millimeter subcaliber unit. And in that case, the subcaliber unit is called a gun, subcaliber, in this case, it was 12 or 13 or 14. So like there's an M12 training, rifle M12 training, and there's also gun M12, which is a subcaliber for a larger artillery piece. So the nomenclature system gets really complicated. Anyway, thanks for the question. That was a fun one to address. If you would like your own question covered in a video format like this, go ahead and head over to Patreon or Utreon. You can help support Forgotten Weapons every day and also submit a question for a video like this one. Thanks for watching.